On the morning of the third day, the sea calmed. Even the most delicate passengers, those who hadn't been seen around the ship since sailing time, emerged from their cabins and settled themselves into deck chairs beneath the pale, almost heatless January sun.
Aren't you cold, Mr. Bottable? You don't have a rug for your knees.
I'm from Minnesota, ma'am. I'm used to the cold.
By evening, the passengers, with 12 hours of good weather behind them, were starting to feel confident, and at 8 o'clock that night, the main dining room was filled with people eating and drinking with the assured, complacent air of seasoned sailors.
I'll have the turbot, please, in hollandaise sauce.
The meal was not yet half over when the passengers became aware that the ship was rolling again. It began gently at first, but rapidly became more and more violent, until only 5 or 6 minutes later, the entire vessel was swinging heavily from side to side.
Oh, dear.
Is everything all right, Mrs. Renshaw?
I may have to return to my cabin. A touch of mal de mer.
But what about your turbot?
Please, Mr. Bottable, don't.
Mr. Bottable watched with interest as more than a dozen passengers abandoned their dinners and made for the door. He had been unusually quiet and thoughtful since the rolling began, and when coffee was served to those who remained, he took his cup and went and sat next to the purser.
Excuse me, young man.
Yes, Mr. Bottable?
I wanted a word about tonight's entertainment.
I'm sorry?
You know, the auction, where the captain estimates how far he expects us to travel, and we all bid higher or lower.
Yeah, what about it, Mr. Bottable?
I was just wondering, do you think he's made his estimate already?
I would imagine so. He usually does it in the afternoon.
Really? At what time?
At about 4 o'clock, I believe. He consults with his navigating officer and they estimate the day's run together.
I see. Well, that's most interesting. Thank you.
No, not at all.
Do you think he took the weather into account?
I'm sorry, Mr. Bottable.
When he made his estimate, do you think he knew there was bad weather coming in?
I couldn't say, sir. I really don't know.
Only I've been thinking, if it gets any worse out there, it might be worth buying some of the low numbers.
You could be right, Mr. Bottable. I doubt if the old man allowed for a rough night. It was pretty calm at 4 o'clock.
Supposing you were allowed to bid for a number in tonight's auction?
Mr. Bottable was staring hard at him now, his small black eyes dancing with excitement.
Which one would you buy?
Well, I'd have to know the range of distances on offer first, and that isn't announced until just before the auction begins. But I'm not very good at it anyway. I am only the purser, after all.
Mr. Bottable excused himself and went up onto the sun deck. He staggered back as the wind caught him in the face and grabbed hold of a rail.
It's magnificent! Absolutely magnificent!
He stood staring out at the darkening sea, where great waves were rising as high as houses, whipped into a frenzy by a ferocious gale.
And you know what? It's gonna make me a whole load of dough!
Despite the violence of the storm, the ship's smoking room was packed. Pink, well-fed men in dinner jackets sat at little tables, their cool, elegantly dressed women at their sides.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Thank you. The auction is about to begin.
Mr. Bottable selected a chair as close to the auctioneer as possible and settled himself in.
Now, the captain has estimated the day's run, ending at midday tomorrow, at 515 miles. As usual, we'll take the 10 numbers on either side of it to make up the range. That makes it 505 to 525. And, of course, for those who think the true figure will be still farther away, we'll also be selling a low-field and a high-field number. Now, we'll draw the first number out of the hat. Here we go. 512 miles. Come along, ladies and gentlemen. What am I bid for 512?
512. In this weather, we won't do half that.
Mr. Bottable had calculated that if previous days were anything to go by, there should be at least £2,500 in the pool.
That's $6,000 in real money.
And he intended to scoop the lot. He'd get them to pay him in $100 bills, and he'd take it ashore in the inside pocket of his jacket. Then right away...
Yeah,
right away.
He'd buy a Lincoln convertible and drive it home. He could just picture Ethel's face as she came out of the house to look at it.
Why, William, wherever did you get that beautiful car?
How she'd swell with pride when he told her.
And to think I called you a loser. You're a clever man, William Butterball. And thanks to you, 1951 is going to be the best year of our lives.
Lowfield. The next number is Lowfield.
Mr. Butterball sat up straight. This was his moment.
As you know, Lowfield covers every number below the smallest in the range. So, if you think the ship is going to cover less than 505 miles in the 24 hours ending at noon tomorrow, you'd better get in and buy this number.
He would wait, he decided, until everyone else had finished bidding. Then he'd jump in right at the end.
So, what am I bid?
£20!
30!
£40!
50!
It went clear up to £130. Others besides Mr. Butterball seemed to have noticed that the weather was rough.
140.
150.
Do I have any advance on £150? Going once, going twice.
160.
Oh. 170.
180.
190.
£200.
I have £200 from the gentleman on my right. Any advance on £200?
Sit perfectly still, he told himself, and don't look up.
Going for £200. Going once.
Mr. Butterball held his breath.
Going twice.
He started to sweat.
Sold to the gentleman from America for £200.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Scotch and soda. Don't drown the scotch.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Butterball.
Oh, Pip, Pip, old sport.
Oh, I see you've had your little flutter. £200, that's quite a sum.
More than you think. It's all I've got in the world.
No.
Don't look so worried. Listen to it out there. I finally found me a bet where I know I can't lose.
When he awoke next morning from dreams of dollar bills and Lincoln convertibles, Mr. Butterball lay perfectly still with his eyes shut, listening for the sound of the gale and waiting for the roll of the ship. Neither came.
Just a minute. What the hell's going on?
He jumped out of his bunk and ran to the porthole.
Oh, sweet, merciful heaven, no!
The sea was as smooth as glass, and the ship was moving through it quickly, making up for time lost during the night.
I'm done for. One of the higher numbers is going to win it. I haven't a prayer.
What do you mean you've lost all our savings?
Suddenly a new vision of Ethel swam before his eyes.
How could you, William? 2 years it took us to save that money, and now you've blown the lot.
Mr. Butterball turned slowly from the porthole and sat on his bunk.
Oh, my God. What shall I do?
Deciding he needed a little air, Mr. Butterball took the elevator up to the sun deck. He found the spot where he'd stood the previous night and leant against the rail, unable to believe how rapidly the weather had changed.
Good morning, Mr. Butterball. Lovely day.
I guess I may as well throw this lousy ticket into the sea. Lowfield, what was I thinking?
Cheer up. Could still win.
Ah, don't humour me. We'd have to go backwards.
I'm really very sorry, sir.
Maybe if I offered the captain a share of my winnings, he'd shut off the engines for an hour. What do you think?
I think perhaps you should have some breakfast.
Perhaps I should. After all, there's no point in crying over spilt milk, as you say in England.
That's the spirit. Worst things happen at sea.
Worst things happen at sea, yeah. I like that.
Do you, sir? I'm glad. When I saw you leaning over the rail just now, I was more than a little anxious.
Really? Why was that?
You'll laugh when I tell you. But, well, I thought you might be contemplating something foolish.
Mr. Butterball picked unenthusiastically at a pair of kippers for 10 minutes, then returned to his cabin. He found he couldn't get his conversation with the purser out of his mind.
I thought you might be contemplating something foolish.
And that's when it struck him. The perfect plan. He ran over to the porthole and looked out. The sea was calm, so he'd have no trouble staying afloat until they saved him. But did he dare risk it?
Why not? Why the hell not?
He began pacing up and down, making rapid calculations inside his head.
The ship's got to stop to lower a boat, and the boat will have to go back maybe half a mile to get me, and then there's another half mile while it returns.
It was bound to take at least an hour, and an hour would knock 30 miles off the day's run. Lowfield would win. It had to. What was the time?
9:15.
Best do it now, then. Do it now and get it over with. After all, the time limit was only midday. Mr. Bottable was both frightened and excited when he stepped out onto the sun deck. He'd need a witness, of course. Someone to see him when he fell. He looked round nervously. There was only one other person in sight. An elderly woman with thick ankles leaning over the rail and watching the sea. Would she do? He decided to find out.
Good morning.
Oh, hello.
Nothing wrong with her hearing, then.
Beautifully clear, isn't it?
I know. You can see for miles on a day like today.
Nothing wrong with her eyesight either. Good. But could she be trusted to raise the alarm? After all, she might have an ulterior motive for not wanting the ship to stop.
Tell me, what did you think of the auction last night?
The auction? What auction?
Well, you know, that silly old thing they have after dinner, selling numbers on the ship's daily run.
Oh, I don't know anything about that. I'm very lazy, I'm afraid. I always have dinner in bed.
Perfect.
Well, I'm glad to have met you. But now it's time for my exercise. I can't miss out on that.
What a nice man.
Mr. Bottable advanced to a position about 20 yards away and peered over the side of the ship. The water looked cold and deep and a long way down. But it was now or never.
Be a man, William Bottable. Be a man.
Reluctantly, he climbed onto the wide wooden top rail.
One.
He took a deep breath and closed his eyes.
Two.
He shuffled forward and prepared to leap, and...
Three!
With an echoing scream, he launched himself over the side.
Yeah! Oh, I say.
The old woman looked round her for a moment, then leaned over the rail, staring at the water where it was turbulent in the ship's wake. Before long, a tiny round head appeared in the foam with an arm raised above it, vigorously waving.
Help! Help! Help!
There you are. I've been searching everywhere for you.
Hello, Maggie.
You know, you mustn't wander off on your own. You're not allowed.
I've just seen the strangest thing. A man dived overboard in his clothes.
Really? Well, that's exciting. Shall we go down?
He said he wanted some exercise, and he dived right in without taking his clothes off.
That's it. Grab hold of my arm. I think it's time for another tablet.
Oh, he was such a nice man. And he waved at me, Maggie. He waved, and he waved, and he waved.